You may be seated. The opening hymn is Christ in our, excuse me, we're going to remain standing for our opening hymn. Hymn number 912, Christ is our cornerstone. To give thanks to God for this great saint, Holly Hollingsworth, who helped actually found this congregation back in the 50s. We will be following the order of service. As you already know, the hymns are in your hymnal, and everything in bold print is the congregational response. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Congregation may be seated. In holy baptism, Holly Hollingsworth was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all of his sin. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?" We were therefore baptized into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead,
by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life.
For if we have been united with him in death, Lord Jesus Christ, by your death, you destroyed death. By rising to life, you certified our forgiveness of sins. We thank you that this gift is freely made available to us all, and that through your word, you inspired and called Holly Hollingsworth into your presence. You washed him, regenerated, and renewed him through your word and sacrament of baptism, and he served you faithfully unto death. We give you thanks, Lord, for all the grace you did in his life from beginning to end. In your name we pray, amen. From the earliest times, the church has associated the Apostles' Creed with our baptismal identity. It is in your bulletin, on the bottom of page 1. Let's rise as we read the words or profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. And our appointed psalm is Psalm 23. We read it responsively. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul.
He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Lord, have mercy upon us. We pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Holly and to all your servants, who having finished their course in faith, now rest from their labors. Grant that we may also be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Congregation may be seated. And our Old Testament reading, read by Jeff, is from the book of Job.
Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were recorded in a book. That with an iron stylus and lead, they were engraved in the rock forever. Yet, as for me, I know that my Redeemer lives. And in the last, he will take his stand on the earth, even after my skin is destroyed. Yet, from my flesh, I will see God, whom I, on my part, shall behold for myself, and whom my eyes will see, and not another. My heart faints within me.
By Larry.
And you were dead in your offense of sins, in which you previously walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them, we too all previously lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our wrongdoings, made us alive. Together with Christ, by grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the boundless riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no man may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we walk in him.
Please rise from the gospel reading. The gospel reading is recorded in Luke 19, beginning at the 11th verse. Now, while they were listening to these things, Jesus went on to tell a parable, because he was near to Jerusalem, and they thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear immediately. So he said, a nobleman went out to a distant country to receive a kingdom for himself and then to return. And he called 10 of his own slaves and gave them 10 minas and said to them, do business with this money until I come back. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we do not want this man to reign over us. When he returned after receiving the kingdom, he ordered that the slaves to whom he had given the money be summoned to him so that he would learn how much they had made in the business they had done. The first slave appeared and said, master, your mina has made 10 minas more. And he said to them, well done, good slave. Since you have been faithful in a very little thing, you now have authority over 10 cities. The second one came saying, your mina master has made 5 minas. And he said to him, and you are to be lord over 5 cities. And then another came, saying, master, here is your mina, which I kept and tucked away in a handkerchief, for I was afraid of you, because you are a demanding man. You take up what you did not lay down, and you reap what you did not sow. And he said to him, from your own lips I will judge you, you worthless slave. Did you know that I am a demanding man, taking up what I did not lay down and reaping what I did not sow? And so why did not you put my money in the bank, and when I came back, I would have collected it with interest? And then he said to the other slaves who were present, take the mina away from him and give it to the one who has 10 minas. And they said to him, master, he already has 10 minas. I tell you that everyone who has more shall be given, but from the one who does not have, even what he does not have will be taken away. But as for these enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them in my presence. This is the gospel of the Lord. Our hymn for the message is My Hope is Built on Nothing Less, hymn 575. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, who gives us more than we need, and from Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, who gave himself more than enough to cover our sin, and from God, the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who gives grace every single day, a grace that overflows through our hearts and gives himself the provision of his presence so that we might serve joyfully in his love and grace. Scripture has many, many overflowing references to God's generosity and surplus. You had a few of them today. God being rich in his mercy, he has more money than we do. He owns everything. We are God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus. How much better creation can he have than being created in Christ Jesus? And then that phrase from the gospel reading, that curious gospel reading from Luke 19, you are to have authority over 10 cities. I mean, who really needs 10 cities? And then, of course, Psalm 23, probably most of you know it by heart, that wonderful phrase, my cup runneth over. As you and I think about Holly, we probably know about Holly's surplus. That is kind of a famous name and a place of business in our community. If you look at Holly's life and you look at the way he lived his life and the many, many things he did, both here at this church, in our community, and really internationally, you might say, well, Holly had a surplus of good works. But I think Holly would correct us all and say, no, it was really God's surplus, and I was just giving it away. Holly was famous for many discounts if you went into his store. Pat started to list them the other day. You know, there was the military discount. There was the Trinity Lutheran discount. There was the clergy discount, although I tried not to take it. There was the friend discount. And in the end, you wonder whether or not anything really had to be paid for at full price. For Christians, getting something discounted is really not the way we look at our relationship with God. We get it for free. And so this idea of free makes us think they're, you know, this is a good deal. Nobody really pays. But of course, somebody always pays. And the word grace implies that. You know, the famous acronym that Christians use for that word is God's riches at Christ's expense. G-R-A-C-E. I remember it. It's easy to spell. So somebody pays the bill. In this case, it happens to be Jesus. So when you look at Holly's life and all that he did, we are always tempted to say, well, this was just Holly operating because that's who Holly was. That's a part truth. If you know what happened in the last 18 months, you know that more than ever before, Holly was impaired. And he was not able to be the Holly that he always wanted to be, which was an active servant. And beyond the weakness in his body, there was the confusion that he dealt with on and off, sometimes quite acute. And there were times when I would stop by for a visit and Holly was sure he didn't belong in that place. He didn't call it his home. So Pat and I talked about this on one occasion and I said, well, why don't we take him to his office? Because in his office, it would be familiar. There are some icons on the wall, and it might cue that, yes, this place he belongs in. It is, in fact, his home. So we did that, and if you have ever been in Holly's office, you're blessed. It's a beautiful office that's wonderfully shared by Pat and Holly, kind of a little halfway wall between the two. And if you walk in, it's like this sanctuary of honoring, you know, Holly had so many honors that it's hard to keep track of. And not only honors, but like newspaper stories. He had like his own PR division. I think somehow Pat may have worked in that office. But it was easy. And that what really struck me when I went into that place. It was so easy to connect Holly with that place because his name was everywhere. And the many, many memory cues of what he did right here, but more so in the community, were all over the place. I lost track, by the way, at 15 different plaques or honors that were on the walls. I never did count them all. So Holly, with chagrin almost, kind of like admitted, well, I guess I belong here, but I think something was turning in his head, and it was this idea that, you know, I didn't really do that stuff. And it may have been a memory shortcoming, but I think it was a spiritual awakening. It wasn't me doing that. It was grace. Grace working through me. The readings that we had are filled with surprising grace. Job believed in God's grace that he would give him the riches of the resurrection. And when my body is dead and my skin is destroyed, I'm going to see God in my flesh. In Ephesians 2, beautiful passage about God's grace, maybe the most clear passage in the New Testament about grace. It is by grace you have saved through faith. It is not of yourself. It is the gift of God, so that no one should boast. In Jesus' parable, he gives money first and then cities later to his servants and authority along with the cities. And then, of course, in Psalm 23, he, the good shepherd, is providing for the sheep abundantly, giving them water and green pastures that are easily accessible. So as I think about those verses and I think about Holly, I wanted to share a verse that I think really brings together the way Holly oriented himself in this world. And I'd like you to share in reading that verse with me. It's at the bottom of your right-hand page in your bulletin from 1 Corinthians 15:10, 1 Corinthians, the resurrection chapter. So let's gather our hearts together and read verse 10 and look for the word grace that appears three times. We read, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me did not prove vain, but I labored even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God with me." So those three different appearances of the word grace have... losing my voice. There we go. First, grace seems to have been given by Paul that influences identity. I am what I am. It's grace that made me that. The second thing is that grace, in Paul's case, was not given with vanity. It was an empty grace. It was seen. It was believed. It was embraced. And you got to remember that it was the resurrected Christ that changed Paul. And when he met the resurrected Christ, he was a different man. And he believed that, and it was going to be used. It was not wasted. Third, it really was grace that was doing the work, not works doing the work. And I think most people in the entire world get that confused. It's always grace that does a true good work. No good work can be done apart from faith and grace. So as I think about those three appearances of grace, and I think about, yes, Holly's surplus, because that is a potent memory in my mind. I thought about the things that I have bought from Holly's surplus and actually came across an old note of mine that I stuck in Holly's file. Everybody here has a file. If you become a member, you're going to get a file. In that note, many years ago, I wrote about the three things that I remember purchasing, and I know I bought more than three things, but the only things that I really retained were, number one, the military duct tape in military army green. You gotta have camouflage duct tape. Number two, the MREs, meals ready to eat. No laughing. And then lastly, the wool socks. These incredibly thick, never felt anything thick like that, wool socks that were also indeed scratchy. So my reference point for the story is what I call Holly's old store before he moved in next to Kinko's. And that's where I spent more time, actually, than the newer store. I remember going through there for the first time vaguely and not thinking I was going to buy anything. I just wanted to check out Holly's store and kind of see what he was famous for in the town. And so I saw a whole bunch of stuff that I thought I could use, but chief among them was the army duct tape. Immediately as I picked up the roll, I realized this is more substantial than most duct tape. The duct tape that was on that roll was heavier, and I later realized that if you used it, it was going to stick. There was an adhesive that the army got that must have been some sort of secret weapon. And if you ever tried to remove it, it would leave its mark. And so I decided I can only use that stuff in extreme need, when I really need something to hold and last. And by the way, I love duct tape because for me, if you know me, you know I oftentimes say duct tape saved Apollo 13, which is actually true. Someone threw a roll of duct tape on board. They didn't do that always. They put it on there. Nobody really knew about it or authorized it, and it ended up being what they used to provide saving oxygen when they had that horrific explosion that shut down so many parts of the Apollo spacecraft, and they were able to seal perfectly a handmade oxygen device, and it was duct tape. Maybe NASA used Army duct tape. I don't know. So as I thought about the duct tape, I thought, you know, that really is about God's grace sticking to us. It leaves its mark. I am what I am by the grace of God, Paul said. So one of the problems that you have when you're an old Lutheran pastor, I now qualify as old, I'm not sure when that happened, is that you're hanging around a lot of people who are either your age or even older than you. And the problem that I've experienced numerous times is when Lutherans especially get older, they get sanctified. And it's really hard to find sin. And that's the way it was with Holly. Well, I did receive help from his boys, who reminded me recently that there were times when he was younger that he had anger issues. Now, I know nothing about anger issues myself, but I suppose if you ask my son, he might say the same thing. We also keep in mind that Holly also had deep wounds and possibly guilt from divorce, which actually was something that Pastor Larava, the very first pastor of this church, helped him deal with. And Pastor Larava wrote a book that I'll reference in a moment, but he was here before there was a church. And he met Holly early on because Holly was one of the founding members who was doing Bible study before there was a church. So when Paul writes, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am," he's saying God is not afraid to stick with me, a sinner. And you know, he called himself chief of sinners. So Pat, who I believe largely wrote the obituary herself, was not ashamed to say that Holly was fired 6 times. And you know, I think that maybe there were some relationship issues there. Now, for those who know Holly, you know, a little bit surprising, maybe a lot surprising, but Pastor Larava, through the early years, stuck with Holly and reminded Holly over and over again that that's what God does with us. God is for us. In fact, remember, duct tape leaves its mark. Scripture says he became us. He joined in with us, and there's that beautiful verse in 2 Corinthians 5, he who knew no sin became sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. He let our sin get stuck on him. That's the wonder of redemption. So in this book that Pastor Larava gave him, and I asked for his, I actually have a copy of the book, but this is Holly's copy. The title is From Here to Maturity, One Man's Walk with Christ by James P. Larava. And he's got a dedication in the front. To Holly, one of my most favorite persons in the world, ! And that's really what God is saying to us in Christ. He's the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Scripture is very clear about that. Jesus knows us individually. He knows all about us, but he's not afraid to say, I love you by name, and then take away our sin. So Pastor Larava wrote that book, And he is trying to impress upon Holly, even when he gave him the book many years later, that Holly, in a way, reflected the same sort of joy and love that God has for us. Pastor Larva had that for him, and Holly seemed to have that for the people that knew him. Many of you know that he initiated a program called Operation We Care, and he largely funded it, he and Pat, and there were over 900 packages that went out. He always gave credit to Trinity. It's like, honestly, I was here during that time. I don't think I did one thing. I think Holly and Pat did like 99% of the work. But that's the way he was. He deferred. And so, in another newspaper article, there were many, as I mentioned, Staff Sergeant Pat Masters wrote a comment, gave a comment to the journal who was interviewing him. And during a DeWitt Part ceremony on Veterans Day, he said something about the package. He said, unlike other care packages that are sent to deployed units and distributed, Hollingsworth packages were specifically addressed to me. He wasn't just an anonymous grunt. He was somebody that Holly, and I remember this, worked hard to get the names of the men who were deployed that he was sending the package to. They mattered individually. I mean, it was lucky that they mattered at all, but they mattered to him personally. You see, when God's grace comes to us personally, it changes our identity. It is now grace that gives us our identity. By the grace of God, I am what I am. So later on that day, by the way, Staff Sergeant Masters, who was a gunnery in a Black Hawk helicopter, he's a gunner, he gave to Holly a flag and a plaque, one of the 15-plus plaques, to recognize Holly. So I'll spend less time on that second item, the MRE. Why? Well, because the MRE was never opened by me. It was never eaten by me. And I suppose, like a fine wine, it sits on the shelf there waiting for me to open it, and it may be even better than it was 20 years ago. St. Paul said, and his grace toward me did not prove vain. So many of you remember the DeWitt Park work that Holly and many of the veterans did and still do, and I appreciate that as a community member who has never done any of that work. Somebody's been doing it every Thursday, and Holly was a leader in that group. But you may remember that there was a plaque by the World War I monument that was missing. It's a curious story. And for 2 years, historians and other folks in Ithaca were trying to figure out what the heck was there. First, there was an argument, well, there was really never anything. They found that the original drawings didn't record anything. And then they found grainy pictures, but they couldn't make out exactly what the plaque was. Someone said it was a Tompkins County plaque, but we have no record of this plaque that was on that memorial for 2 decades. And then somehow it mysteriously disappeared. It was like my MRE, never used, never really processed, never really embraced by the community or anyone. And the reason that I included that gruff verse at the end of Jesus' parable is, first of all, Jesus said it. Bring those people here and slay them in my presence. Secondly, it kind of reminds me a little bit of Holly. He had kind of a rough edge to him, a sharp edge. And it also makes us aware that Jesus is king, even if you don't believe it. That's the point of that parable, maybe the major point besides stewardship. What do we do while we're here on earth? And if you believe that Christ is king, you serve the king. But if you're like me and you don't eat your MRE, you let it sit in the shelf because it's really not that interesting, or you don't think you need it. It is mercy ready to experience that has never been experienced, except Holly experienced that mercy. Do you know where the abbreviation GI comes from? Genuine GI? I did some research, and according to the history website, and Wikipedia, they agree, it stands for galvanized iron. Fascinating. The early buckets and waste bins that the Army issued had GI on the side to tell you it was galvanized iron. See, Jesus has appeared in this wonderful, loving way as a galvanized piece. And underneath it, there is indeed a hard edge. He wants us to utilize his mercy. Experience it. Don't leave it unopened. And finally, we get to our wool socks, the last item that I remember purchasing. And I did use them. And they were extremely warm. In fact, sometimes almost too warm. And I think about those wool socks when I think about all that Holly did. Too many jobs to keep track of, too many plaques to number, all the stuff that he did in the community. At Trinity, I can name you over and over again different jobs that he did besides helping to have the courage to start the church with other people. And I realized that what Holly did with this grace is he let it warm his soul and he worked with that. He didn't think about those socks. And when I did wear the socks, the only time I thought about them is when they got too warm and I finally had to take them off. Or, on occasion, I would feel a scratch because they were indeed scratchy. St. Paul said at the end of this verse, "But I labored even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God with me." I think that when I think about what Paul's saying, you almost get the sense he's taking a little bit of pride. And every now and then, God has to remind us, because that creeps into all of our lives. And I suspect it may have creeped into Holly's life. I never heard it, but I suspect it did, knowing the nature of man. That every now and then, God will let you feel a scratch. It's, oh, yet not I, but the grace of God in me. So as I think about Holly's many, many works, there's one that really epitomizes the way I will remember Holly. I know you can't see this. It's my own picture that I took of Holly. He is, I'll leave it out there so you can look at it later. He is snow blowing in our parking lot, and those who relied on him, as our preschool and after school did, knew that he came here early in the morning, usually before sunrise, maybe 5, maybe 5:30. I wasn't up then. But I was up on this day, and there was about 12 to 14 inches of snow, and there's only one car in the parking lot because preschool and after school was closed that day. Preschool and after school was closed that day. He's snow blowing for one car that belongs to Pastor Robert Foote. One matters. There's nobody yet who has tried to do the jobs that Holly did, even a few of them. And I don't know what's coming for America or for the church when we have this void, because he did it not to do good works. He did it to witness to the love that he had received. Yet not I, but the grace of God in me. That verse, by the way, is in 1 Corinthians 15, the great resurrection chapter. Paul is remembering the mercy of Jesus after he shows up in his glory at the resurrection and says, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you?" "I am Jesus." And from that point on, God's grace to Paul left a legacy. If you look at Holly and you say, "Oh, that's Holly surplus," he would say, "No, that's holy surplus. My cup runneth over." Praise God for his grace that made Holly holy. Amen. We rise and we sing hymn 570, "Just As I Am." Thank you. Your grace is sufficient. The grace that you have given to us identifies who we are now and forever. Your grace should never be accepted in vain. Your grace is what motivates us to do all that we do. We are created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he prepared in advance for us to do. We give you thanks for our friend, our brother, our spouse, our father, our grandfather, Holly Hollingsworth. He left the mark of grace. I pray, Lord, that you would be with Pat, and I pray that you'd be with Larry and Tim and all the family. Comfort them, Lord, to know that he was a good and faithful servant, and to know that he, like St. Paul, has experienced the mercy of God and the resurrection of the dead according to the promise believed. We thank you, Lord, for Easter and the comfort of the resurrection, which you invited people to touch, see, and believe. It's what makes a difference in our life, Lord. The receipt of grace is the resurrection. Lord Jesus Christ, give us the peace that the world cannot give as we abide in your promises and your presence. We pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and forever. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. We pray. Lord God, our shepherd, you gather the lambs of your flock into the arms of your mercy and bring them home. Comfort us with the certain hope of the resurrection to everlasting life and a joyful reunion with those who love and have lived in faith through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all. Amen. I think people may have read the bulletin that we hope that you can all stay for fellowship afterwards. We have a luncheon prepared. Graveside service will be held after the luncheon later today. I also want to say one word to the family about exceptional care from the whole family. Jeff was down here many times, and the boys came several times, and they got things done. It was a delight to see. So praise be to God. Let us go forth in peace. And we recess to the tune of Lord, Dismiss Us With Your Blessing, hymn number 924.